Hello, and welcome to Controllers Tech. Today, we're going to continue with our STM32 IoT series, which we have been covering over the last four videos. In those previous videos, we learned how to connect the ESP8266 with the STM32, how to configure UART communication, and how to establish a connection between the STM32 and ESP8266 over a Wi-Fi network. In the most recent video, we specifically looked at how the STM32 connects to the MQTT broker and publishes messages to multiple topics while using free RTOS. Although everything worked well, we noticed one limitation. The publishing speed was still quite slow. At the moment, the STM32 takes around 4 to 5 seconds just to publish a single message. So, in today's video, we are going to explore how to use DMA to significantly improve the publishing speed. Along with that, we will also see how to subscribe to different topics and make use of the data that we receive from them. By using DMA, the communication between the ESP module and the MQTT server becomes much faster. This directly reduces the time required to publish a message. Now, when an STM32 is subscribed to a topic on MQTT, data of unknown length can arrive at any time. Because of this, using DMA is not just an improvement, but almost a necessity while handling subscriptions. Before we move further with the project, let's quickly review the connection diagram. The ESP8266 and the USB to TTL modules are connected in the same way as we did in the earlier videos. The ESP module is connected to UART4, while the FT232 module is connected to UART1, which we will use for logging purposes. In addition to these two connections, I have also connected an LCD where the received MQTT messages will be displayed. This LCD is connected through I2C, with PB6 serving as the clock line and PB7 as the data line. The LCD is powered directly from the STM32 using the 5-volt supply. I have also added a simple LED to pin PB2. Later in this video, we will control the LCD display using the data received from the subscribed MQTT topics. Make sure to place a 200-ohm resistor in series with the LED. Otherwise, there's a chance the LED could burn out. That completes the hardware connections for this setup. For the software part, I'm going to reuse the project that we created in the last video, which was part 4 of this series. All the functions, including the ones related to our TOS, are exactly the same as before. To keep things organized, I'll rename this project to Part 5. Alright, the project has been renamed successfully. Next, remove the old debug configuration, since a new one will be created automatically when we build the project. Also, delete the previous ESP8266 STM32 files, because I have prepared a new set of library files for this project that include DMA support as well as subscription handling. Now, copy the new ESP8266 STM32 library files along with the I2C LCD library files into the project folder. You can download these files from the link given in the description of this video. Once downloaded, you'll find these files inside the SRC and Inc. folders, exactly where I'm placing them right now. I have already explained in detail how to connect a 16x2 LCD with STM32 using the I2C peripheral. If you're not familiar with that, you can check out the separate video and article linked in the description. With that, let's open the ESP-STM32C file and take a closer look at it. Most of the code inside this file remains the same, with only a few important changes. In the ESP initialization function, we now call howUART_receive_DMA. This enables the DMA receive feature for the UART peripheral. The DMA will be configured in circular mode, which means it will keep receiving data continuously in the background without requiring CPU involvement. This reduces processor load and ensures data is captured in real time. Here you can also see the MQTT subscribe function, which will be used to subscribe to a particular topic. Another important function is ESP-MQTT Handle Incoming, which is responsible for parsing the incoming data. It extracts useful details, such as the topic name and the actual message sent by the broker. Since we have added some new hardware in this project, let's open CubeMX to configure them. First, we will enable the RxDMA for UART4, because this is where the ESP8266 is connected. Make sure the DMA is configured in circular mode and that the data width is set to byte. Next, we enable I2C for the LCD. I am using I2C1, and here you can see pins PB6 and PB7 configured as the I2C clock and data lines. After that, we configure PB2 as a GPIO output pin, since this is where the LED is connected. The FreeRT TOS configuration is already done in the previous video, so we don't need to change much here. Currently, there are three tasks. Two tasks handle publishing, and one main task is dedicated to MQTT. We could create a separate task for receiving data from subscribe topics, but in this project, I will handle that directly inside the MQTT task itself. That completes the hardware and peripheral configuration. Click Save to regenerate the project. Now, let's build the project once to verify. The project compiles successfully without any errors, which means the DMA integration works perfectly with our existing code. Next, let's go through the ESP-MQTT subscribe function to understand it better. Just like other MQTT functions, the procedure here also follows the same general steps. The first step is to build the subscribe packet, which is made up of three parts: the fixed header, the variable header, and the payload. The fixed header starts with the subscribe packet type, followed by the remaining length. Here, the first byte of the fixed header is 0x82, the subscribe packet type, followed by the field representing the remaining length. After that, we move to the variable header. The variable header contains the packet identifier, which is a 2-byte value. You can assign any value between 1 and 65535. In the example shown here, the identifier is 10, but in our function, I have set it as 1. Next comes the payload, which holds the actual topic the client wants to subscribe to. The payload is structured as topic length, followed by topic name, followed by the quality of service QoS. Since both the topic name and QoS are provided in the function parameters, we first calculate the length of the topic and then arrange the data in the proper sequence. Finally, we calculate and place the remaining length in its correct position, subtracting 2 bytes from it. Once the subscribe packet is ready, we send the command at +sipsend to the ESP8266 to inform it about the number of bytes we are going to transmit. After that, we wait for the greater than sign from the ESP, which indicates it is ready to receive the data. At this point, we transmit the binary subscribe packet and then wait for the acknowledgement from the MQTT broker. The acknowledgement packet from the broker always begins with a fixed header byte of 0x90, followed by the remaining length. The variable header in this case is simply the same packet identifier that the client sent earlier. Finally, the payload of the acknowledgement contains the return code, which indicates whether the subscription was successful. A successful acknowledgement will contain 0x90, 03, 00, 01, and 00. Here, 0x90 is the packet type, 0x03 is the remaining length, 0x00 and 0x01 is the packet identifier, and 0x00 is the success return code. In my function, I'm simply waiting for the 0x90 byte, assuming that the rest of the packet will follow correctly. Now let's briefly discuss the ESP-MQTT handle incoming function. This function is quite complex to explain in detail here, but in simple words, it parses the incoming data from the RxDMA buffer. It specifically looks for the plus IPD string in the receive data, and once found, it extracts the topic name and the message from it. If valid data is found, the function stores the topic name and message into the arrays passed as parameters. Now let's move on and write the main code. First, I will re-enable the connect to Wi-Fi part because now the ESP module processes these functions much faster with DMA. To start testing, we will first send just the connect and publish packets to see if the publishing speed has improved. We still have two publish tasks sending data every 1 second, and the MQTT task processing these requests. Since we regenerated the project, the Friertz queue type has been reset back to 16-bit data. So, let's change it back to a structured queue with the data type we defined earlier. Now, let's build and flash the project to the STM32 board. Open both the serial console and the MQTT Explorer. The Explorer is already subscribed to the topics that our STM32 will publish to. Finally, run the debugger to start testing. I have not fast-forwarded the video, so you can clearly see that the processing speed has increased drastically after implementing DMA. The STM32 client is now publishing data at a much faster rate compared to earlier, when we were using the blocking mode for UART communication. Both values are being updated every single second, exactly as we programmed the client to do. So, by using DMA to receive data from the ESP module, we were able to make a very significant improvement in processing speed. Now, let's move ahead and see how the STM32 client can subscribe to different MQTT topics and then process the data received from them. To start, open the main.c file. After the STM32 client successfully connects to the broker, we will call the function ESP MQTT subscribe to subscribe to a topic. This function takes two parameters, the topic name that the client wants to subscribe to and the quality of service level. In our case, the STM32 will subscribe to two topics, controllers.txt/LCD and controllers.txt/LED. The data received on the LCD topic will be displayed on the LCD screen, while the LED connected to STM32 will be controlled by the data received on the LED topic. Next, let's go back to the MQTT task. Inside this task, we first need to create arrays to store the topic name and the message that we receive from MQTT. Then, inside the infinite loop, we will call the function ESP MQTT handle incoming to handle any new incoming data. We pass the topic and message arrays as parameters to this function so that it can fill them with the extracted data. Now, once we receive data, the first check will be whether the topic name is controllers.txt/LED. If it matches, we then check the message for that topic. If the message is on, we set the LED connected to pin PB2. If the message is off, we reset the LED. Next, we check if the topic name is controllers.txt/LCD. If this topic is received, we will display the message directly on the LCD. We can use the LCD library functions to handle this printing. First, initialize the LCD. Then, place the cursor at the start of the top row and print the topic name. After that, move the cursor to the start of the bottom row and print the message received. That's all we need for the basic subscription handling. Also, remember that we already have a ping request configured for every 20 seconds of inactivity. Keep in mind that receiving messages from a topic does not count as activity. So, if the client is only receiving messages, the broker will still think the client is idle. That's why the ping request is very important. Only publishing and ping requests are counted as activity by the broker. So, in our code, we update the counter inside those sections. Now, let's build the project and flash it to the STM32 board. Run the debugger and check the results. You can see that publishing is working perfectly. The client is publishing data to two different topics every second, and we can confirm this by looking at another MQTT client that is subscribed to those topics. Now, Let's test the subscription part by publishing a message from MQTT Explorer to the topic controllers.txt/led. First, I'll send the message on. As soon as the STM32 client receives it, the LED connected to pin PB2 turns on. Now let's send off. You can see that the LED immediately turns off. If you send any message other than on or OFF, there's no effect on the LED, which is exactly how we coded it. On the serial console, you can also see the topic name and a message displayed, confirming what the client has received. So the LED topic is working fine, and the client is handling the messages correctly. Now let's test the second topic. I'll publish a message to controllers.txt/lcd. Let's start with Hello World. As you can see, the LCD instantly displays the message received from the LCD topic. Let's try sending another message. This new message also gets printed on the LCD without any issue. So now we have our STM32 acting as a fully functioning MQTT client. It is able to both publish data and receive messages from multiple topics. Not only that, we are also processing the received messages and using them to control external hardware like an LED and an LCD display. By using DMA, we were able to greatly improve the way the STM32 handles requests from the ESP8266, and I highly recommend using DMA in similar projects. That brings us to the end of this video. I hope the explanations were clear and easy to follow. In the future, I might also cover MQTT implementation with TLS encryption, depending on whether it can be fully integrated with the ESP8266. You can download the complete project files from the link provided in the description. If you have any doubts, feel free to leave a comment. Thank you for watching, and have a great day ahead.